Many people have asked why the Indo-Aryans attacked the Indo-Aryan invasion theory. The reason is simple. Denial of the Indo-Aryan invasion theory provides Indo-Aryan speakers in India with an in-situ development in India and wipes out Dravidian-speaking people from Indian history, replacing them with alleged white Aryan speakers. Debate over the Aryan invasion theory has ranged in India during the past decade. The Aryan invasion theory stated that the Aryans entered a civilized India where the Dravidian and other people lived in walled cities. The Aryan invasion theory made it clear, as indicated by the Vedic literature itself, that the Aryans were clearly nomads who attacked the cities of North India. Since there was nothing in the Vedic literature which identified them as civilized, the Indus Valley civilization was credited to the Dravidian-speaking people. In the 1990s, population geneticists became popular. At first, the science was used to identify connections between people in a positive fashion. As more and more research was done, it was recognized that many Eurasians carried African genes. Although history and archaeology illustrated that Africans had migrated to Eurasia since 3500 BC, the geneticists began to refine their methods to differentiate between Africans and Europeans who carried the same gene. By refining their methods and giving the same gene different nomenclatures, the geneticists were able to claim that the Africans and Eurasians, although they shared the same genes, there was a difference between the genes. Based on the monogenetic theory that man originated in Africa, geneticists accepted the fact that anatomically modern humans originated in Africa between 200 and 100,000 years ago. Next, the geneticists claim that anatomically modern humans left Africa 60,000 years ago. On the surface, this was a neutral conclusion, but in reality had deep implications for genetic anthropology. First of all, radiocarbon dates and skeletal remains make it clear that there is no single African black population. As mankind developed in Africa, different people appeared at different times, which were all similar in color, but had selective features which indicated differences. Differences in size and differences in structure. Thus, we have the first out-of-Africa population. Researchers believe that the first out-of-Africa population was the Australians. The Australian people have curly, wavy or straight hair and abundant body hair and sloping brows with prominent ridges. The next group were the San people. The San people have curly hair, the brows were vertical, and there was less prominent eyebrow ridges. The San people were of medium build. The next group were the Pygmy people. The Pygmy people have curly hair, the brows were vertical and without prominent eyebrow ridges. The Pygmy people were very short in stature. Finally, we have the African Dravidian Oceanic type. These people have curly and straight hair. The brows are vertical and without prominent eyebrow ridges. The African Dravidian Oceanic were all tall in stature. These types of Negroes are supported by craniometric and skeletal remains recovered from archaeological excavations. The craniometric and skeletal evidence supports multiple migrations of Africans from Africa, not one single migration as alleged by many geneticists. Because the archaeological evidence supports Africans existing in Eurasia generally, it explains why Eurasiatic people carry African genes. Eurasiatic people carry African genes because they were carried to Eurasia in recent times by African people. The Dravidian, African, Oceanic Negro people. Genetics, like other sciences, is Eurocentric. So these researchers used the genetic data that Eurasians carried African genes to imply that since the Out of Africa event occurred only once, they claim, in 60,000 years ago, any genes carried by Eurasians that are derived from African genes must be the result of a back migration, i.e., Eurasians took the African genes they acquired after 60,000 years ago back to Africa. The main problem with this theory was that it is not supported by the skeletal remains and archaeology, which shows that blacks entered the areas at different times since 60,000 years ago. Although the geneticists have no archaeological and skeletal evidence to support the presence of Eurasian and Mongoloid people in this or that region 5,000, 15,000, 20,000 years ago, they use statistical methods to claim that Eurasians possessed this or that gene earlier than the same gene in Africa. Now Eurocentrists can claim that, yeah, blacks were in Eurasia, but those blacks in Eurasia are all derived from the Out of Africa event, not recent migrations. But these blacks are different. First there were the Australians, then there were the Sand People, then there were the Pygmy People, finally the Oceania Negroes. They did not all derive from the Out of Africa event. Africans have been migrating to Asia for hundreds, for thousands of years. There was only one problem with the idea that there was one single migration of African people to India. That problem was the Dravidians. The Dravidians have long been recognized as Negroes by anthropologists. They shared blood type and cultural features. In 1999, Cavisso et al. Wrote a paper claiming that Dravidians carried the M1 haplogroup. This was evidence that the Dravidians must be related to Africans because haplogroup M1 is primarily found in Africa, especially Ethiopia. Later, Hindu nationalists took over the Indian government. They began to fund researchers, and the 1999 Cavisso article was ignored, and geneticists began to claim that haplogroup M1 did not exist in India, even though we have the Cavisso et al. 1999 study and the Gonzalez article, which came out in 2006. Today, the Hindu nationalists claim that Dravidians originate in India, and since they share the same genes with the Indo-Aryan speakers, Indo-Aryans too must be native to India. Following this reasoning, the Indo-Aryans claim that since they have been in India since time immemorial, especially North India, they must have been the founders of the Harappan civilization. The myth that Indo-Aryan people have always lived in India provided the Hindu nationalists a fuel to claim that the Aryan invasion was a myth created by the European colonialists. But they forget that the whole idea that Indo-Aryans are Europeans is also a myth created by the colonialists. What the Hindu nationalists did not know is that the archaeology, linguistics, and the 1999 Cavisso et al. Article point to a recent 3,000 to 2,500 migration of Dravidians from Africa to India, not an ensued development of Dravidian speakers in India. The Hindu nationalists must use genetic research to provide them with a prominent role in India history. Without the myths fostered by genetics, there is no Indo-Aryan role in the creation of the Harappa civilization. In summary, Indo-Aryans attack the Aryan invasion theory because it makes them recent immigrants to India.